In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
Amen.
We are here this afternoon to invoke the Holy Spirit upon our young people, the next generation to carry the word of Christ in the society of our day. A daunting task indeed. But they are excited about what they can do for the betterment of church and world. We are excited with them. Let us call to light our sins as we celebrate Confirmation and Eucharist, a special day.
Your Son took care of a contrite of heart.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Here is my shepherd whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will bring justice to the nations. He will not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not snuff out. In faithfulness, he will bring forth justice. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
gracious, my dear young people. You may be seated. The gospel passage that you chose for your confirmation from St. John's Gospel, chapter 14, is an elucidation of a conversation that Jesus had with his apostles during the Last Supper. And it reminds me of a deacon in one of our parishes recently who suffered advanced pancreatic cancer. And at his most recent doctor visit, he was told there was nothing more that medicine could do for him, that he was in stage 4 and would soon shortly need hospice care. It took a few days for Deacon Sam to absorb all of this that was coming down upon him rather suddenly. So he decided to call together his scattered family, along with several of his fellow deacons, for a Sunday night supper. And sensing the importance of this invitation, surprisingly, everyone came. The wine and the grilled steaks and the apple pie had never tasted so good. And after the supper, Deacon Sam shared the diagnosis and its implications. And then he said this: "You know how much my work with the street homeless has meant to me over the years. I know that each of you, in your own way, will keep this work alive after I'm gone. You'll do it because you love me. Am I right?" Most of those gathered answered him with hugs and tears and heartfelt promises. When the enemies of Jesus began to close in on him, he called his friends together to share a supper. The Passover supper, the most important of Jewish festivals on their calendar, commemorating the rescue of God's people, the Israelites, from 400 years of slavery under the Egyptian pharaohs. Jesus' farewell words here, as recorded in John's Gospel, were his last testament to those who he considered family. And like a doting parent, Jesus prepares them for a sad departure by focusing on three essential truths he wanted to get across. One, that all of them are loved by him and his Father. Two, whoever loves him in return will show it herefrom, keeping his commandments. And three, the Father will send them a helper to teach them how to carry on after Jesus' departure. His helper, the Holy Spirit. Similarly, friends, we are the family to whom Jesus says, "Whoever loves me will keep my word." And your young people about to be confirmed. You notice, in an average day, day to day, we are bombarded by a zillion words about many different things. Lots of words. Social media presented to us. A zillion words every day coming every which way. Words telling us what to do and what not to do. Words telling us what is wrong and what is right. Words from friends making plans with us only to change plans to more exciting plans. Words coming at us from our communication devices, our iPhones, our iPads, our cell phones, texts and television and internet. They are also bombarding us printed words in newspapers and magazines, on billboards, on highways and byways. Announcements, words issued to us by our teachers in lesson form, and words directed at us by our coaches in sports, Amidst all of these words from day to day, which of these words do we hold on to, and which of them do we discard? There is so much. And then there are special words, spoken or in print, maybe even through email or text or that special Hallmark card that we try to hold on to because they connect us with special others. They make connection in our hearts, in other words. These are the kinds of words that Jesus is speaking about today when he asks us to keep his word. Because his words are special. You notice when we gather together at Mass, there are certain postures that are deemed Catholic. And there are certain postures that are deemed heathen. But when it comes to Catholic posture, you notice that when we hear the lessons from the Old Testament, or from the lessons of St. Paul in the New Testament and the other apostles, we sit, as you are doing currently. We sit to listen to the lessons. But then when it comes time for the gospel, we rise, we stand to give our sole attention to the words of Jesus in case you were falling asleep when you were sitting down. Now it's time to be attentive to the message of Jesus Christ. That's the word, or the words that we are supposed to hold on to. And dear young people, we have just heard an excerpt from the Lord's farewell words meant for us as well. Shall we answer him with hugs of both those we love and those who drive us crazy? Shall we answer the Lord with tears of repentance for our sins and gratitude for the mercy of God that we have come to know over our lives? Shall we answer him with heartfelt promises to keep his mission alive in us, of universal love, justice, and peace? Today we situate you, our young people, in that upper room that night when Jesus was giving his farewell words to his friends, begging you to carry on his work, keeping his commandments, and spreading the love of God to all whom you meet. The grateful and the ungrateful, those you like and those you don't like. A variety of peoples, white, black, brown, who need eloquent signs that they are loved by God. Even though telltale signs of that love are given only begrudgingly by others. Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my words. I dare say there is a wealth of unexpressed love in the world. It's one of those chief causes of sorrow and depression in the lives of many people. What might have been said or might have been done that can never be said or done anymore? Or what awful things have been said that cannot be unsaid? Most of us have run across such words, but probably would rather not dwell on it, including the regret that comes from knowing that we failed properly to act on or live out the love that we claimed we felt for another. Is love that finds no expression of it at all really love at all? In today's gospel, Jesus speaks to us in a manner that seems to settle the question definitely for Christians. Jesus is telling us that there is really no such thing as unexpressed love of God. For Jesus makes it abundantly clear that only those who keep his message and do his will can be considered part of that circle of love that comprises both him and the one whom he calls Father in heaven and their Holy Spirit. We've all heard people say, I should have visited Mom more often at the nursing home. Or I wish I would have told my kids that I love them. Maybe we've said these kinds of words ourselves. But we might not, however, have made the connection between this personal regret and what it has to say about our Christian vocation as followers of Jesus. Is it possible that we could reach a point in our lives where we realize, albeit too late, that we fail to act on the clear injunction of Jesus here? Anyone who loves me will be true to my word. You say you love me, show it by keeping my commandments. Jesus says. Clearly, friends, Christianity cannot be a religion that's just in the head only. It has to be lived out. Our Christian faith has to be acted on. It has to be spoken of. And it must be demonstrated in a myriad of ways. The good news is that we can and should begin today to avoid that possibility of that deep regret that comes with having waited too long to express our love and loyalty for God and each other. A day will come regretfully when it will be too late to do so. So today, candidates, you step forward to indicate the special place the Lord has in your lives. It is a moment of decision, and perhaps the most important decision you have made thus far in your lives. There will be other decisions to make forthcoming, but hopefully they will be enlightened by your faith and what you have learned through standing to hear the gospel message of Jesus Christ and applying it to your lives. In this ritual of confirmation, the bishop's solemn prayer over you, followed by the anointing of your foreheads with the sacred chrism, are the two most important parts of confirming you in Catholic faith, signifying that you are permanent members now of the Lord's body and ambassadors of his message. The Church uses this sacred anointing to suggest that you are set apart for God's purpose, and that you are empowered by God to cooperate in the divine plan to sanctify the world by the witness of your Christian lives. The Lord is counting on you in this regard. Your lives herefrom, as Catholic Christians, are meant to be eloquent stories of your love for Jesus Christ, observing his commandments, and with your carrying forth the Lord's words and gestures in your Christian regard for other people. There are a lot of people out there, my dear young people, with a deep hunger for God. Every day, I don't know how to express it. We Christians, Catholics, are asked to assure them, to reassure them out of the love that we have for Jesus Christ, the Christ of our martyr. May the good Lord who has begun all these good things in you bring it to completion of the day of the Lord that we are waiting for. Can I ask the sponsors to please rise for just a moment? Thank you for helping us with the confirmation ceremony for our young people today. You are already living the Christian life, so you understand well the mysteries of our connection with the Lord and how important his words out for day-to-day living, out of a sense of grace and fulfillment and that inner peace that God wishes us to have. I see your role pretty much to be important beyond just the pageantry of the afternoon, but for the long term, if you can see yourselves doing so, for which I would ask if you could periodically check in on him or her to make sure that what they pledge to God today, they can be faithful to it, come what may, be it good or bad, success or failure. We would want these, our young people, to be able to sense the presence of the Lord in their lives every step of the way, and to sense genuinely the warmth of His Spirit. Can we do this for them? The Church thanks you profoundly for this task, this sacred task, as I'm sure their parents do, and I as well. Thank you. And I will ask the young people to stand alongside their sponsors for the profession of the faith. To please rise. I invite your friends to pray along with me and Father Mahalik, your pastor, as we invoke the Holy Spirit upon these, your sons and daughters. He will graciously pour out the Holy Spirit upon them with his abundant gifts, while we anoint them to be more alike to Christ. Let us pray a moment in silence. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who brought these your children to new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, freeing them from sin, send upon them, O Lord, the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete. Give them the spirit of wisdom and understanding. Give them the spirit of counsel and fortitude, the spirit of knowledge and of piety. Fill them, Lord, with the spirit of the fear of the Lord, through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
Lord be with you. Let us rise and pray. We bring together our sentiments and prayers following the sacred anointing, asking God's choice, his blessings upon our young people, our children, those who have received the anointing and the Holy Spirit.
For those sons and daughters of God confirmed by the gift of the Spirit, that they give witness to Christ by lives built on faith and love, we praise the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For their parents and godparents who led them in faith, that by word and example they may always encourage them to follow the way of Jesus Christ, we praise the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Holy Church of God, in union with Francis, our Pope, Ronald, our Bishop, and in thanksgiving for Bishop Perry and all the bishops, that God may gather us together by the Holy Spirit and may help us grow in unity of faith and love until his Son returns. In glory, we pray to the Lord. For all people of every race and nation, that they acknowledge the one God and Father, and in the bond of common brotherhood seek his kingdom, which is peace and joy in the Holy Spirit, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of our families and friends who are unable to be with us today due to illness, social distance, or God has called them home to be with them in his eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Pour out over your church, O Lord, the spirit of courage and a longing for your peace, with a strong faith to support our living forth rightly the gospel in these times. May this precious oil of the Holy Spirit flow over us to fill us with your gracious benediction. We ask through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept graciously these your servants, O Lord, together with your only begotten Son, so that Son, with his cross and with his spiritual anointing, they may constantly offer themselves to you in union with him and merit each day a greater outpouring of your Holy Spirit through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts, and let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just. It is our duty and our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. Ascending above all the heavens and sitting at your right hand, he poured out the promised Holy Spirit upon your adopted children. Therefore, now and for ages unending, with all the hosts of angels, we sing to you with all our hearts, crying out as we acclaim. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Holy Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, so that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate this Eucharist. On that night, he was betrayed. He himself took bread, and giving thanks, he said a blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." the mystery of faith.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Accompany with your blessing from this day forward, O Lord, those who have been anointed with the Holy Spirit and nourished by the sacrament of your Son, so that with all trials overcome, they may gladden your church by their holiness of life, and through their works and their charity, foster the church's growth in the world. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may the blessings of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you and remain with you always.
Our Mass is ended. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your lives.
Amen. Amen.